also a traditional Jewish, Christian, and Muslim.
Atheist and agnostic, as well as many times.
Hi.
Hello.
Welcome
to the Holy Watermelon Podcast.
Man, that was terrible.
That was one of our worst last week. I was like, oh, we're getting so much better. But not all weeks can be winners.
No.
I'm Katie.
I'm Preston.
And we're your hosts. And today we are wrapping up, I guess, a mini-series on the largest organized religions around the globe.
So you say organized. Hinduism is not very well organized.
No.
And the same can be said of... Well, okay. The same can be said less reliably of Shintoism.
Which is our topic today. What would you call these then? The ones with the stamp of approval? Major religions?
People like to call them the world religions because they're huge in population and have spread over pretty much the entirety of the earth. And Shintoism didn't used to have a centralized authority until this idea of state Shintoism showed up.
Which we'll get into. Yeah. We're jumping ahead a bit.
Yeah, but it's better if we start a little closer to the beginning on this one.
That's my rewind noise. It's not a very good one, but I always like to start with the numbers for these religions. So I'm just looking at the notes. Shintoism started in the 4th century, so it's quite old. You're giving me a look.
I mean, the way that Shintoism is visible today, it seems to have started around that time, yeah.
But being an indigenous religion to Japan and a nature worship religion, it's probably fair to say it started even before then.
Absolutely. In fact, we've talked a lot about labels in the past, and Shintoism is so vast that one label, while it might seem really good in the moment that we'll use it, there is going to be part of this whole ball of wax where that label just doesn't stick.
Well, we don't like labels in religion because exactly they don't always fit. And I think that's fair for Shintoism because I had trouble wrapping my head around it. I got there, but it was a lot of digging and research, whereas something like Buddhism, where it's all numbered, it was way easier to figure out their beliefs and practices.
Yeah. So when you say it's a nature religion, that's true in a lot of ways. But also you do have Shintoists who don't really worry about the river god or the mountain god or the sky god of their area and only really pray to their ancestors.
Yeah.
And then you have some that will do the occasional prayer to their ancestors and will be a lot more worried about their own agricultural profitability, let's say. And they'll pray to the god of rice or the god of the rain. And spectrum.
The basis, I guess, of Shintoism is the worship of the kami. And the closest English translation we have for kami is spirits. And as Preston was saying, spirits can live in the rivers, in the mountains. They can also live in man-made objects or as people. And that's where we'll get into state Shintoism. But the emperor was considered
a great kami.
Not to be confused with
the communist.
As I was saying, I was like, that sounds really bad.
The emperor was a great commie.
A great commie. That's what clued my mind. There are about 100 million Shintoists in the world because it's a religion of Japanese origin. They're predominantly in Japan or of Japanese descent.
So you'll find a lot more on the east coast of Canada and the United States.
West.
It's not even that hard. They're on the west coast of Asia and the east coast of North America. And also a lot of Japanese people.
You literally said that backwards.
Did I?
Yeah, it's the east coast of Asia.
Yeah.
And the west coast of Canada. You can't even...
Words aren't even that hard, but here we are.
Some words are hard.
And there's also a huge Japanese population in Brazil.
Interesting.
Which is not on the west coast of South America.
It's on the east coast. Yeah. Very good. Geography lesson for you today as well.
I'll get there.
So Shintoism is not an exclusory religion. You can be Shinto and something else. I think it's almost borderline encouraged.
Yeah, we talked about a couple episodes ago in our discussion of Buddhism that an awful lot, probably even most Shintoists are also Buddhists.
That one's incredibly
and
common.
And Confucianists, which is kind of cool. This amalgamation of ideas. And as we get into Shintoism a little bit more, you'll see how that's actually really easy to come across.
I think it's a good way to be, too, because you can really utilize the different beliefs and practices for certain points in your life. And there's a very specific reason that most people die Buddhist. But to be able to actually use religion to find guidance and comfort and shift that religion as necessary in your life, I think is probably a healthy thing.
Yeah, I think so.
Do you want to go more into Shinto and Buddhism being best friends?
Yeah, for sure. So in the early 7th century, Buddhism had spread all the way across from the top of the Indian subcontinent, all the way east through China, up into the Japanese borders. And it became so popular that Prince Skew, I don't know, we spell it S-K-U.
The barcode.
It is spelt like that we typically transliterate it in English. I assume that my pronunciation is acceptable if it's not correct. Prince Skew, or Skew, I don't know, he sponsored Buddhism as the state religion of Japan. Which sounds really weird when Shintoism was already wildly popular as the native indigenous religion. And I think this illustrates how Shintoism wasn't seen as a religion in the same way that they saw Buddhism or Christianity as a religion. That Shintoism was just a fact of life. That it was a thing that you did. You would pray to your ancestors. You would pray for things, and it wasn't saying prayer makes it feel like it would have been a religious action, but it was simply you go to a place where you can communicate with the spirits, and that's it. That's all it was, or that's the way it was seen anyway. So there was no real conflict in making Buddhism a state religion. And so over the next 150 years, it became more popular and more kind of forced by the government as it being the state religion, this Buddhism. And so Buddhist monasteries and temples could be found in every province by about the middle of the 8th century. So they kind of, well, they didn't kind of, they did coexist. And Confucianism about the same time arrived in Japan and became very popular as a good way of guiding people to be good neighbors, which was kind of addressed in Buddhism pretty well, and not actually explicitly laid out in any rigorous religious form in Shintoism. And so it kind of became part of that triune religion of the state, which is kind of nifty. This Confucianism was brought into Japan basically attached to Taoism, which of course is the Chinese understanding of spirits. And because that's what Taoism basically is, it was never really adopted by the Japanese people because Shintoism already filled that role. And so those three, Confucianism, Buddhism, and Shintoism, have coexisted and have been tightly attached to each other firmly for more than 1,000 years in Japan.
I saw a stat in my research, and it was it was the Japanese census, and I was saying that 70% of the population is Buddhist and 60% of the population is Shinto. And if anyone here is good at numbers, you know that is grossly over 100%.
It sure is.
Grossly.
And that's because people are comfortable being both of those things. Mm-hmm. And it's, I don't think you're allowed to check off more than one religion box in the Canadian census.
It's been a long time since I've done a census, but what if you are a multi-religious household? You must be allowed to.
Honestly, it's been a long time since I've looked at the census. I don't remember if they ask about the household or individual members for that.
Yeah, because...
I could be wrong. You totally probably could check off multiple boxes on the Canadian census.
Wow, I'm curious.
Right? I mean, we've got a census coming around soon. Do we? So, yeah.
Oh, good.
I've applied for that job, so hopefully they don't listen to this episode of our podcast and write me off as somebody who does not care enough. we'll see.
You're going to be the person I avoid when the census worker, I'll just do it online.
Right?
Yeah.
Everybody should be doing it online.
I want to make an inappropriate joke about how you're probably used to that, though.
Right? I've spent years of my life trying to talk to people who don't want to.
Not that guy again.
Right.
So funny.
So it's kind of nifty that these religions coexist. And things did get kind of complicated more recently in history. The imperial power has always been tied tightly to Shinto theology, the emperor being the highest ranking priest and also the newest of the gods, which is also a, as we discussed what a god is in one of our earlier episodes. I think it's perfectly fair to say that anything that is worshipped is a god, and all of the kamis seem to have worship directed to them. So even though the word is pretty faithfully translated in the word spirit, they're also gods.
Yep, fair.
Yeah.
I think when we, in my mind, mm-hmm. jump in if I'm wrong, when we use the term spirit, I feel like that's the manifestation of the god. Right? Am I making sense?
Yeah, I follow you. I think that's pretty fair.
Yeah. That... we have a different idea of how other gods show up or don't show up. Mm-hmm. And I think in Shinto, they show up as spirits in things.
Yeah. So even the mountain being a powerful figure in the theology of this divinely created land, having a mountain show up to you doesn't work, but having the spirit of the mountain show up to you, that is a lot more reasonable.
No.
In whatever form that might take, it's probably not going to be a billion ton rock.
Do you, and this is off topic, do you think that the idea of spirits and kami in the sense that they speak to their ancestor spirits, do you think that influences Western culture's idea of, like, ghosts and this idea of an afterlife or an after present that your spirit can hang out on the ground and haunt things?
It might. I think it does for some people.
Or was there enough in, like, did we have that idea in the West before we had Japanese influence?
We've definitely had the idea of ghosts in our cultural mind before we had strong connections with Japan. The Far East.
Interesting. Okay.
So, yeah, more recent history of Shintoism, things got a little hairy. We mentioned it right at the very beginning.
No.
We mentioned at the very beginning this idea of state Shintoism that, well, what year was that? Did I write it down?
1945? Is that the year? Late 19th century?
No, that's the end of that problem. Okay. Yeah, more or less the end of that problem. So in the late 19th century, there was this nationalist effort to separate Buddhism from Shinto kami worship. A lot of people just trying to get rid of outside influences and really shore up what was the Japanese identity. Christianity also lost a little bit of popularity there too. So they tried to push out Buddhist influence, which I don't think was a great move as a personal opinion, seeing what Buddhism brought to the table. I don't agree with that move. And it seems like a lot of people agreed at the time. There was a lot of public shrines that came under government control, and people were encouraged to worship the emperor, encouraged often by force.
Oh.
Things got really
strongly encouraged.
Yeah. Nearly 80,000 shrines shut down with the persecution of traditional religious Shintoism, which is, I mean, also a hard enough thing to define, but anything that incorporated anything that wasn't strictly approved by the state became a big problem for people's lives.
Hmm.
And that lasted for, I don't know, not really a long time, because the middle of the 20th century came around and Japan joined the Second World War and lost the Second World War. And the peace treaty that really cut them out of the war forced them to separate religion from the state. And this, of course, included a clause that required the emperor to no longer claim a divine status, which seems perfectly reasonable to any secularist, was a huge problem for Japan.
Yeah, and right, we talk about the separation of church and state and emperor giving up his divinity, but we still think Queen Elizabeth is divine, has the divine right to the throne.
Right.
So that doesn't sound, you know, this isn't so backwards, I guess.
Right.
Of thinking that your leader is somehow divine, because we still in Western culture think that.
Yeah, the Allies forced Japan to build a line between church and state to the point where they couldn't have a state religion anymore. England still has a state religion. The Queen is
head of the Church of England.
Yeah. So it's kind of funky. There's actually a lot of religions that enjoy a special state status on this planet.
I mean, even the U.S., though it's off the books, we've had this conversation before. You cannot get elected president of the United States and not be a Christian. It just doesn't.
Yeah.
It won't. Even though, it'll be a long time before we see that happen.
Yeah. Even though America is officially a state with no state religion, there's a de facto status for Christianity that everybody seems to agree, at least, well, I can't say everybody, because there's an awful lot of far more reasonable voices that say, no, there's no state religion. An awful lot of Christians say, this is a Christian country. And the fact is that even though it's not that way on paper, it is.
What does the $1 bill say, one nation under God?
I thought it said, in God we trust.
Oh, isn't there another one, though?
Sure. It's been a long time since I looked at American money.
No, you're right. It does say God we trust. But there's that's a saying, too. I don't know what I'm thinking of.
Pledge of Allegiance
includes
the phrase, one nation under God.
I was like, why is that in my head? But you're right, in God we trust is on the dollar bill. So clearly, there's not much separation there either. So,
well, and see, even that was the product of the fight against the communists.
Not the commies, the commies.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm hilarious today. Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah, it was thrown onto American money because money is a thing that people see every day because the wonderful money. Pleasures of capitalism is that you will be spending money. And so the fight against communism was fought on the money itself.
Yeah.
By pointing out that we're better than those godless communists because we have God on our money.
Uh-huh.
And I think we talked about this a few episodes ago and in our discussion of what gods are, that in America,
money
is God.
Let's dive into what Shintoists actually believe. And I have written down their creation myth. There's two books. Neither of these are considered divine. There's no one divine being or God. Like I said, it's all around commies. And these books, the Kojiki and the Nihongi, are from the late 18th century, and they explain the origin story of Japan. So their creation myth is how Japan came into being.
I think it's interesting that they don't agree exactly. They tell more or less the same stories, but there are some details that are different. And Also, I mean, you can go ahead and buy these books and read them, but they don't actually really figure into the religious life of most Shintoists.
No. yeah. What this origin story is not like a day-to-day thing like you'd hear the Garden of Eden or what
happened. I mean, it's weird how much evangelical Christians put so much emphasis on Genesis, especially just the first three chapters.
Yeah. Right.
It's like that's how far they got in their book before they got bored. Bored,
probably. Oh, that was bad, Katie. But probably. So, yeah, like Preston said, this doesn't really play into day-to-day life, but it is the how Wolverine became Wolverine, how Japan showed up.
Right.
The first couple, Izanagi and Izanami, descended from heaven to the island of Japan, and they produced the sun goddess, or Kami, named Amaterasu.
I'm not going to correct your pronunciation. I don't think I can do better.
That
looked pretty good.
Thank you. I think that's a compliment. And that's about it.
Yeah.
There are a few more, a couple more Kami came from that. And
well, they're not the first Kami, but they're the first with a personal attachment to the whole land of Japan, I think.
Yeah.
It's their cosmology is kind of vast, and there's a lot of dealing with creators, but there's no real prophecy to it at all. It's just, this is where we come from, and that's it. Yeah,
and that's why I can't really expand on it, because that's basically all I could find, is that this is where the country of Japan comes from, and yeah, that's about it, and that we're, I want to say ruled by spirits. That's not the right term, but I don't want to say we're ruled by spirits, but that spirits play a part of our world.
And there's spirits everywhere. The rivers, the trees, the forests, the mountains. You've also got your ancestors. If you've gotten into genealogy very much, you'll find that a lot of families in Japan have got decently far back records of their families, so they can track their genealogy, is the word I've said and then lost. They can track their genealogy and see how they're connected to the Kamis that they have shrines for in their ancestral homes, which is pretty nifty. Of course, there's a lot of those that have been lost over time as well. And of course, the greatest of those human Kamis are your conquerors and your emperors, your big people who did so much in their life that you could expect that they can help you in your own life.
Hmm.
And of course, you've got Kamis that find their origin in ideological myths, like the God of the Thunder.
Right.
The story around him explains why there is thunder. Lightning, rains, rice, all kinds of things.
Did you know there's a Kami in Mount Fuji?
I fully expected that there was. My brief survey couldn't actually find his name, as I was just going through random lists of things. I didn't actually specifically search for what is the Kami of Mount Fuji, though that thought actually had entered my mind. What is his name or her name? Is it a he or a she?
The Kami of Mount Fuji is a princess.
Ooh, I named like that.
Konohana Sakuya.
The longer the name, the harder it is to pronounce.
I know, because you gotta like string it all together. Konohana Sakuya. Konohana Sakuya. Use that one.
I like it. I won't try and say it, but I like it.
And
so Mount Fuji's a girl.
Mount Fuji's a girl.
I like it.
A girl mountain. It kind of makes sense.
Sure. I mean, it's just one boobs. As opposed to what you're miming.
Boobs.
It's a huge mountain.
Yeah.
I mean, it looks that way anyway.
I think it's quite a big deal.
I have no idea how it compares to the other mountains of the world.
And the symbol of this princess is a cherry blossom.
And there's a shrine set up at the base of it specifically to ward off eruptions.
Got to keep her happy, right?
Right. Last thing you need is that princess having a freak out.
So bad.
But true, right?
I mean, yeah, I wouldn't want Mount Fuji to erupt just because she's angry.
Right. Which is definitely the narrative that goes along with an eruption, is the mountains are angry. Yeah. Everywhere in the world, that's the way it goes.
Yeah, so I would say she's definitely probably one of the bigger commies along with the sun goddess. And I think you have a few more in mind to talk about.
None whose names I can pronounce.
That's fine.
At all.
Tell me about some.
There's a almost triune set of creators who are responsible for the creation of the world as a whole rather than just Japan.
Mm-hmm.
That separated the earth from the heavens. Their names are long and complicated, and I just can't pronounce them. And they're kind of cool. And then there's another... Well, before I get on to the next two, these three just kind of came into existence. There is a time before them, but they are not the product of procreation. And they don't seem to procreate either. But they just create. And then there was two more gods whose names are also, that I can't pronounce them, that are more specifically associated with the heaven and the earth as a whole. The whole of the skies, the whole of the earth, one being a lot bigger than the other, I guess.
Yeah, well, that one had his work cut out for him.
Right. And then after that, there's a series of male-female pairs. And the two that you had mentioned as being the creators of Japan are one of those male-female pairs. And
they just kept going because there's a ton of them.
And then each of those created all of the features of the land that have kami associated with them, or they created the kamis who created those features of the land. It's all about the storytelling on how the world came to be the way it is.
Yep. I'm really excited about this next part, Preston.
Go for it.
Oscar winning film, Spirited Away, is all Shintoism.
Yeah.
All of it is so exciting to my brain. Spirited Away, it's right in the name. There's tons of spirits. If you haven't seen it, I highly recommend it. And we have the radish spirit, and they take all these different forms. And this is the idea that kamis can, you know, be nature, inanimate objects, or people. And
where does the story take place?
Japan?
No, it was like, where in Japan? What is...
Oh, in a bathhouse. Is that what you mean?
Yeah, that's okay. What I'm going for.
Yeah, I was going to get to that.
Okay.
when I posted in our Discord, which you should hop onto, that I was researching Shintoism, I sent the gif of No Face stuffing its face.
Yeah, it was
That's my
adorable.
Personal spirit.
A little off-putting, but adorable at the same time. No Face is hard to digest.
Sometimes when I'm hungry, I'll text Bryant that gif of No Face just gorging himself. Spirited Away takes place in a bathhouse, because cleanliness and pollution are big themes in Shintoism. So there's no moral code like we see in the Abrahamic religions, where you don't eat certain food or you have to dress a certain way, or
your regular behaviors have no real effect on Shintoism at all.
Except for this concept of clean and dirty and polluted. So there's a lot of themes in Spirited Away. Well, it's literally in a bathhouse, and then there's the river spirit that comes and is filthy, and Shen like helps clean him up, and the Haku, her little friend, is a river spirit that, sorry, spoiler alert, he's trapped because his river was paved over. So the director, Hayao Miyazaki, is like big on the environment, but this is also like hugely important in Shintoism as well. And in my research, Hayao Miyazaki, Shintoism is important to him personally. So we say in North America that cleanliness is next to godliness. In Shintoism, it is literally godliness, to the point where physical purity correlates directly with spiritual purity. This is part of the reason Japan is like a super clean country. I mean, there's other reasons in their cultural values, like, but
cultural superiority. They're just better than us because we're trash.
Wow, Preston.
If you walk out on our streets right now and see how much garbage that our people throw on our streets,
yeah, but trash. Oh yeah, but I don't think they go day to day being like those North American pigs.
I mean, you don't need to say it when it's so easy to see it.
To see ourselves. I know honor is a big value in Japan, and I think that plays into anyway.
Absolutely.
I'm digressing from the topic of religion, but the term kigari means unclean or defilement. And there's a couple that make sense, and then a couple I was personally offended by. So death, disease, and rape are all kigari. They're all unclean defilements. Death, I'm like, and we'll get into death more, is like, man, you don't really have a choice. But it's considered unclean. Also, childbirth and menstruation are kigari. They're impure, dirty
things.
That's
pretty standard. Well, in fact, this whole list is pretty standard for what we're familiar with in the Abrahamic faith.
That's though, true.
That if you're going to go to the place of worship, typically the temple rather than the synagogue, there is a need to be physically clean. Mm-hmm. And our hygiene standards have evolved a lot since then. If you were menstruating 3,000 years ago, you were going to be physically dirty.
That's true. And you'd be locked up from basically everyone.
Yeah. So I understand where it's coming from. But as our hygiene practices have evolved, so should our outlooks.
Yes. Being in the state of kigari is, I mean, the way they would put it is bad for you, but it also pollutes the community around you. So it's important that you remedy that by purification rituals. And that is sort of the big piece of Shinto worship, is this idea of purifying your space. I didn't make any notes on it because I couldn't find a ton of stuff on it. But even when you're moving into a home, you purify it so that the kami that from your home or your ancestral kami that are coming with you in their little shrines feel comfortable in your new home.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
I like to be comfortable in my home.
All right, I cleaned my new home when I moved in. So, yeah.
So these ideas are not alien.
My dead grandma would feel the same.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It seems perfectly natural and reasonable to me.
So on the topic of kigari, death, like you said, death is kigari. And so Shintoists don't deal with it because it's a state of impurity. Which is where Buddhism...
I think that's fair to say. Shintoism doesn't deal with it.
Fair. Shintoism doesn't deal with it. So this is where Buddhism just like swaggers in. And yeah. they say that you're married Shinto and you die Buddhist. And it really bothered me. I Googled it and couldn't find it. But I remember in religious studies class, they said there's a reason people marry Shinto. And I think it's like some economical reason. Like, I think there's some like gifting, there's some benefit to being married Shinto, and then you die Buddhist because worst case scenario you get reincarnated, best case scenario you reach nirvana instead of being in kigari, instead of being dirty. So
right, it's interesting that for Shintoism there is the sense of a heaven and a nether world on either side of the mortal realm, but the heaven of Shintoism is just the plane where the kami live. And it's not an expected destination for the departed dead. And the netherworld, when it shows up in Shinto myth, is the place for unclean kami and occasionally the unclean dead. When a kami dies, that's part of the story, is they go to this netherworld. but it's not a promised thing that when you die, you're going to go to either place. They don't address that at all. And so Buddhism absolutely fills in that blank space in the story.
Yep. And so because of that, Shinto cemeteries basically don't exist. So there you go. They're all Buddhist cemeteries.
Right?
Yeah.
You're going to hold on to this vessel and the guy that was in it is going to go make another one. It's an interesting way to see the world that you're able to kind of fence off the two different ideas and still adopt both. I don't know. It's not something you see a whole lot among people who grew up in the Christian tradition.
No, I think this is, I don't want to say it's the only example, but it's the best example of two religions coexisting.
Yeah.
In a symbiotic way.
Yeah, it's weird that it's not like one really absorbed the other. There's not a whole lot of obvious syncretism.
Yeah.
Where one just changes and adopts values of the other. It's being both.
Yeah, no, they're two very different
and separate things. Yeah.
That just happen to live together well.
Yeah.
Like you and me.
Right?
Well, we just had a moment. Day to day, what does it look like to be Shinto?
The weird thing about day to day Shintoism is that there's things that are what you would expect from anybody, that the way that it got away with being almost secular is really interesting. And so somebody who's just a Shintoist who maybe doesn't adopt Buddhism for the sake of this example wouldn't look really any different from an atheist, apart from the occasional visit to a shrine, which could happen once a year, once every decade, once a month, once a week, who knows.
In my research and my understanding is that most people, the note I have is that, you know, we talk about Buddhism as this way of life. Is it a religion? We had this conversation. I would actually say Shinto is more of a, air quotes, way of life, because most people in Japan don't even consider themselves religious. And I think that because being Shinto is so intricately.
Oh, okay. Sure.
And then my brain was trying to do intricately connected to being Japanese. You don't even, like, I don't even think they see the line between religion and being Japanese. It's like,
it's just a thing you
it's
do.
It's like liking poutine as a Canadian. You can't separate that as a food, eh? It's just part of the culture.
But you know that it's food.
No, it's my heart and soul.
Okay. You live and breathe poutine.
I live and breathe poutine. I don't think you understand. It's just when you ask a Japanese person if they think they're religious, the answer is no. But, you know.
Even if they're practicing Shintoism on a regular basis. It's interesting. Religion is complicated. We've said this before. I'll say it again. That's
why we have content our reality. For the rest of our lives.
Right. It's interesting that just like there's no singular way to be Shintoist, there's no monolithic historical founder. That's not a thing. The ancient history of Shintoism is lost. Mm-hmm. We understand that these things are worshipped. We know they've been worshipped for as long as history records, and that's it. In fact, I tried looking up the etymology of the names of a lot of kami and found nothing at all. Their names are so old that we don't even know what they mean anymore.
What they mean.
Yeah. Some of them we do, or some of them we have guesses, but for a lot of them, we just don't know what they mean anymore. There's no solid scripture that is the canon by which worship is measured or anything like that. There's, like you mentioned, those two books, and that's kind of it. You've got a handful of family stories, and different families will tell the same story different ways, but there's no set of scripture that unifies them at all.
Yeah, it's just like this inherent belief that, you know, kami exist.
Yeah.
And that you need to keep them happy.
Yeah. In fact, there's a lot of argument on how to define Shintoism. And the most popular scholarly definition for Shintoism is the belief in kami.
Yeah, and this makes me feel better about my struggle to wrap my head around Shintoism this week.
Yeah, it's, we're trying really hard to make it a thing that is an approachable discussion topic, because it's a very complex thing.
I might argue that this might be one of the most complex, maybe next to Christianity.
It's weird that it feels more complicated than Hinduism.
But Hinduism has its like set of beliefs and then ton of gods that you can pick and choose from, whereas this doesn't have a set of beliefs and then a ton of gods.
Right. And with Hinduism, there was a foundational scripture that came in with this religion as it moved into the Indus Valley. We don't have that for Shintoism. Yeah. It's just the idea that they're a kami. That's it.
Part of kami worship is, of course, shrines. And this is, like you said, you can even see in Spirited Away when they're driving to their new home. There's little spirit shrines on the road that they point out. And shrines can be like a tiny home shrine or a tiny side of the road shrine. Or they can be massive community shrines. There's about 80,000 shrines in Japan, and this is where kami worship takes place. There is a kami hangout in a shintai. So this is the specific object within the shrine where they're residing. And this can be basically anything, and they're often man-made as well. So you have your shrine, it's a little house, and then there's something in the shrine where the kami's like, hi, here I am.
So is there any sort of preparation that a person has to undertake before they visit one of these shrines?
Thank you for the for the lead in, Preston. So back to the cleanliness and the purity, impurity. You have to wash your mouth and wash your hands, which feels very common. That happens in Islam as well, for sure. And I'm...
Realistically, if you're going to visit anywhere, it's polite to not be dirty.
But ritual cleansing is a little different than just not being dirty.
Yes.
And this Absolutely. Would be ritual cleansing. So people pray at shrines. They make monetary donations. They leave food. I think they leave flowers as well. Yeah, you're just leaving small tokens of your appreciation for the kami.
Sounds pretty all right.
I think so. Ooh, this one fact was fun, and I made a note because, like, literally as I was researching. So you can tell the difference between a Shinto shrine and a Buddhist shrine by the torii gate. So these are, there can be really simple torii gates that are really like two posts and a beam. But there's definitely like a look.
And there's a stereotypical look that you'll recognize them by.
And as I was studying this, I saw someone with a torii gate in their yard, and I was like, do you know what that is? You know what that is?
It's hard to say if you don't know the person.
No, and I didn't, but I was like,
You could have just a dude who's way into Japanese tradition and, you know, hangs a set of swords on his wall and will never get married.
Oh, you're
and
bad.
Then on the opposite end of the spectrum, you'll have somebody who's really into their religion.
Yeah, or it could just be somebody who thought it was a nice yarn. I want to say yard and lawn ornament. So I'm curious who lives there, but...
Right. Could be a family that genuinely opens their home to anybody who wants to worship the kami.
Maybe. I'd be curious what kami lives there.
Right?
Yeah. The largest and most important shrine, Google it, guys. It's really cool. It's called the Ise Grand, which is dedicated to that first sun goddess, Amaterasu. And my note says, and I'm going to read it, it's really fucking old. It was originally built in the 4th century, which is where we start having this record that Shinto is a thing. But it's been, obviously it's been rebuilt several times since. But it's pretty remarkable that there's been a shrine there for 1700 years. And it's massive. And yeah, you can go as a tourist. Shintoists are very welcoming. And they'll teach you how to, like, say a prayer and leave a thing for a kami. And because they're, you know, open to other religions coming, like, you can just go and check one out. So if you're in Japan, check out the Isi Grand.
On that point, I think it's really interesting that Shintoists follow the model that we're familiar with in Western Asian henotheism, where when you go to a city that has a shrine to the local god of the city or the city state, that you're expected to give a sacrifice in those situations. And you're absolutely welcome to do the same at a Shinto shrine, that anybody can. That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
It's how you show that you are respectful of the community.
I will definitely visit Issei Grand when I go to Japan. I don't know when I'm going to Japan, but I will visit when I go. One story I remember from my religious studies class is apparently there's a Shinto shrine in the Toyota factory. Makes sense?
Yeah, sure.
And my religious studies teacher came from a very devoutly Christian family, and he like told his in-laws that there was a Shinto shrine in the Toyota factory, and they sold their Toyota. They couldn't handle that there was another god mucking around with their car.
I understand from a Western perspective the idea of having even a Christian shrine in the workplace is problematic for a lot of people. I mean, it would be annoying for most atheists, I think, but we've actually made it so much part of our culture that you must be separating your work from your religious life, that maybe that's part of the feelings there.
Probably. I mean, I don't know, because I don't know if we want to say it's more, maybe it's just, it's probably just ignorance. I'm talking.
I mean,
can you hear me thinking while I'm talking? It's probably just ignorance, because I remember we went for Vietnamese pickup not that long ago, and they had a little Buddha on the counter, and there was coins and things on it. Like, obviously
if you go to a East Asian restaurant, it doesn't have to be Chinese, it could be Laotian or whatever.
Yeah, it's Vietnamese.
Not seeing a shrine would be actually kind of weird.
Well, yeah, but this is where I'm saying, like, I mean, I don't know if incredibly devout Christians wouldn't eat at a Vietnamese place because it's Buddhist.
What's funny,
but I think we ignore that, and then you hear a story about Toyota and you're like, my pearls,
right? Some of my family who are pretty Christian but not like real hardcore Christian go for Chinese food on Christmas because they're the only ones that are open and they like to eat out.
Fair.
And it's funny that, and I think an awful lot of Jews eat out Chinese food in the winter season as well. I've observed it more in the winter than the summer, but I doubt there's actually much difference time-wise, to be honest. And both Christians and Jews and Muslims have this idea that you have to stay away from idols of other gods. And yet we all love Chinese food, and almost all of them have these shrines.
Well, and that's what I mean, where I think it just comes back to ignorance.
They just don't know that it's a shrine.
They just, right? Or you wouldn't even,
I don't know,
clue in.
Right.
To, you know, especially in, and again, this is more with Buddha, because it's we have a physical manifestation of what Buddha looks like, or Budai.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you notice very few places have both, apart from retailers.
Yeah. I was going to say, with retailers, we've commercialized this idea of Buddha and Zen Buddhism, and so much that I honestly don't even think people clue in that it's a religious. Oh, even before we hopped on, when we're like, yoga's not just a sport, it's like a thing. But we've commercialized it so much in the West that we don't realize how spiritual and religious it actually is.
yeah, yoga is incredibly religiously charged.
Yeah, so it's funny. I read the Bhagavad Gita after our Hinduism episode, which mm-hmm. not great for timing, but yeah, it's mentioned a whole bunch in the Bhagavad Gita. Anyway, we went on a bit of a tangent, but I hope you learned something in that tangent. The last piece, I don't have a ton of notes on it, but Shinto shrines are run by priests, and the priests...
or at least the big public ones
are. Oh, yeah. Big public. Obviously, a home shrine or a small roadside shrine wouldn't. But the big public shrines, the term is kanushi, not to be confused with tanuki, like Mario. I'm kidding. And they'll conduct rituals. They're a little bit of a customer service piece. They'll talk guests through who are not Shinto practitioners through the ringing of the bells and the prayers and the... monetary or whatever sacrifices, and they can communicate with the kami. You can be a man or a woman priest. There's no restriction on that like there is in the West or in Western practices, and you can marry as well as a Shinto priest. They're pretty chill.
Yeah, it's not so hard to be a Shintoist as it is to be, say, a Catholic priest, which is not the life for me.
Not the life for a lot of people. They're leaving in droves.
It's true. All right. So I found a couple of nifty ideas. I have them attached to the name Hawaii.
No, I'm going to let you talk about this because I saw this and...
decided
not to go down that route. So,
I feel like an awful lot of people, when they hear the word kami, there is the instinctive... response to add another portion to that word in the English language, especially say 70 years ago. Kami was always attached to the word kazi. Kamikaze means the spirit wind, and it's attached to the Bushido principle of honor until death, which, as we've seen in many religions, occasionally means violence. And so when you have airplanes flying into aircraft carriers, kamikaze is the motivation for that action and came to be the name of that portion of the Air Force that has made that word become popular. What's interesting is that Shintoism actually had a presence in Hawaii long before the Second World War. And there's a really cool place called the Daijingu Temple in Honolulu. It houses shrines to Amaterasu. And
oh, you did it!
I did. I went for it.
And you did it better than I did it both times.
I can't say it's better, but I did it smoothly.
Fair. I'll give you that. Amaterasu. Fuck I like you.
It. Nice and smooth. Yeah. I like it. So there's shrines to Amaterasu. There's shrines to other traditional kami, as well as shrines to George Washington and Abraham Lincoln. They are worshipped as kami because of their status as the founder of the Union and the repairer of the Union, which is pretty cool, I think. And there's also other shrines to other heroes, and also one to all who have died in war, which I think is a... part of the reason why it's still a popular shrine to visit. It's moved around a few times as the American government has seized their lands for one reason or another during the Second World War. But they're in Honolulu, and it's a pretty hot tourist spot. So that's the cool notes I have for Hawaii and Shintoism. But Shintoism is pretty much... anywhere where you have a large population of Japanese migrants.
I didn't do any research on it. Now I'm curious, are there non-Japanese Shintos? I mean, I presume.
I fully expect that there are, but I don't think there's any real big scholarly work done on them. I think if you were to look through a census, you'd probably find a handful of people who identified as non-Japanese and Shinto, but I don't think there's lots.
It's definitely not an evangelical religion.
No, not at all.
And then with that, it's really hard to explain.
Right.
Even if you did get into a position where you could.
Realistically, it's easy enough to say, you know what? I'm going to become a Shinto. All I have to do is clean myself and pray to whichever god I select in a manner that matches what I Google. And then I could say to my own satisfaction, maybe not to everyone else's, yeah, I'm a Shinto now. But there's nobody asking anybody to do that, which is interesting.
Yeah. Any final thoughts as we wrap up the last episode in this World Religions mini-series?
So I've pointed out a couple of similarities, I guess, and also contrasting points with Hinduism. Mm-hmm. That Hinduism was a name that I don't love for the religion because it's a name thrown on them by white people. And the name Shinto has a similar trickiness to it. It's from what I've been reading, it seems like Shintoism isn't a word that's used a lot by practitioners of Shintoism. We've talked about how it's like a lot of Shintoists don't see themselves as religious. That's part of the reason. But also the word Shinto, which when you look it up, it's said that it means the way of the kami. The Japanese way to say the way of the kami is kami no michi, or something close to that.
Very smooth.
I try. And the name Shinto is hardly a Japanese word. It's derived from the Chinese words shen dao, which does mean the way of the spirit or the spirit way. And Tao being also visible in the word Taoism, which we had mentioned briefly earlier as the Chinese religion around the spirits. So Shinto comes from that Chinese Shen Dao, which got transliterated into Japanese as Jindo initially, which basically denoted non-Buddhist deities and popular belief. So Shinto is another problematic title that we've just accepted as this is the title that gets used for this thing all the time.
Yep. All right.
Naming things is important before you can really study them. You have to be able to identify what you're talking about. But sometimes the way we name things is just nonsense.
No, and this is... I mean, definitely an instance of imperialism, even if it's Chinese imperialism.
Yeah.
And it's you know, and the example you give is Germany, right? We just called them Germany, and they're like, no, it's Deutschland.
Yeah.
And we're like, no, it's Germany. So it's,
those
it's,
dirty Romans.
Oh, good old.
Imperialism does terrible things for anthropology.
Yeah, the privilege.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I hope that made some sense, Shinto, today.
If you followed along as well as we were able to present what we know, you've learned a lot, I hope. I know I did.
Do we want to give a little preview about what we can expect next since we're shifting gears again?
Yeah. Now that we're done this mini-series on religions, we're going to get back into the tougher conversations. And so what do we have first on our list?
Oh, next, I guess 2 weeks from now, we are covering belief, the concept of belief. And I'm really excited about that one. That was a big topic. It's a big topic.
It's huge and complicated. We cover epistemology. We cover the nature of knowledge. For those of you who don't know what epistemology is.
We're going to cover.
We cover.
Yes. It's definitely not recorded already.
I don't think I used the past tense. I think I used the...
No, you said we covered.
I thought I just said we covered.
Oh, okay, well, carry on.
Oh, well.
Okay.
What I said doesn't matter.
I said what I said!
And then we're going to talk a little bit about the weird...
The C word! Cults.
And that'll be a lot of fun. I'm looking forward to that too.
I started the research on it, and we're gonna have a conversation when I stop recording.
Absolutely. And then after cults, we're going to talk a little bit about satirical religions.
This was a fan request, so please know that we do check our social media and our Discord if there's something you want to hear. The satirical religions episode is brought to us by Mr. Tim. Thanks, Tim.
And then we're going to look into what it means to be an atheist or an agnostic. Both of them.
The lack of religion. Woohoo! I'll read it when we get to the episode, but I love my notes for this.
Yeah, it'll be good. And then you'll see where we go after that.
Well, yeah, we will all see where we go after that. If you like what you're hearing, if you can drop us a review on Apple Podcasts, please follow us on Facebook and Instagram, and we do have a Discord available for you to join and check out. Link is on our social media. If you have any requests, concerns, or hate mail, please email us at holywatermelonpod@gmail.com.
Peace be with you.
No, I was like, are you going to say something else? Okay. Peace be with you.
By the late Middle Ages, the Christian prophecy.
God is near.